everyone. Welcome on board. Good morning to you all. So some people are even they are very early in the morning. So early birds today. Sorry for those, because we are in GMT3. So let me share my screen and I will start, my friends. Okay, so this is my screen and I guess you are seeing that now. Okay, if anything is wrong, Elena Egemen, please inform me about it. From my side, it seems good. So
yeah, it seems,
by the way, good. Perfect. Okay. So I want to talk about design thinking and how it can be applied to software testing, which is for me an interesting subject. That is why I chose those. So I try to, currently in my job, I am a consultant and a trainer, so that I am interacting with very different companies in different domains. All those companies are really very interested in design thinking. And when I am teaching design thinking, I saw that it could be applied to anywhere. And in the poll that our poll, I saw that almost one third of the community already applied it into software testing, which is for me very interesting and surprising, by the way. But good, of course. So let me talk a little bit about first design thinking, what it is and how it came up and why it is that much popular. Then I would be switching to the integration part of it to software testing. So according to Tim Brown, who is the president of IDEO and also could be regarded as one of the main contributors to the design thinking space, he thought that it is a human-centered approach, which is very nice for us as testers. Testing is also human-centered. So, and it is trying to come up with this. This is kind of a methodology, design thinking, and it is putting innovation onto the table. And, but in a way, it is the intersection of possibilities of technology, needs of people, and requirements for business success. So in a way, you are solving some people's problems and you need to solve those problems in an innovation or in a creative way. So that is how we explain design thinking. It is a method to use for problem solving. I think you all saw this. By the way, I first get in touch with design thinking when I was in Boston in the United States. I also visited the company IDEO and they have introduced us design thinking, which was more than 10 years ago. But to be honest, it is popular for the last 5 years. It is more and more popular. It was not that popular 10 years ago. For sure, it isn't a rocket science, but it is popular for the last 5 years, to tell you the truth. Basically consisting of five main stages where you try to solve the problem. So there is a step zero just before these five stages where you are putting an objective. So you set a target, what will I solve? So that starts with this one. Then you do empathy to the audience. So who is suffering from the problem and how can I understand them better? Then after the empathy phase, you came to the define phase where you are now empathy is over. I know my audience, so that I need to define their point of view. So where do they suffer? What are their sub problems? What do they need? So those things should be defined properly in the second stage. Then, according to the findings you have after empathy and defined phases, you come up with ideas in order to solve those problems that you have stated in the define phase. So ideation phase, which is also one crucial and essential state. Then after that stage, you come up with different ideas. For sure, some of them are very wild, some of them are very rational. So you need to do prioritization and you need to pick some or one in order to proceed with prototyping. So you just turn those ideas into something concrete. So in order to make them tangible, you are prototyping, you are doing prototyping, and with those prototypes, you need to go back to your audience and show them what you have built and test your prototype with your audience. So this is basically how the whole design thinking works. It is very nice, very clear, very understandable. But you know, in every resource, they say that design thinking could be applied to anywhere. It is not a methodology used by only designers or used in design space. By the way, testers are also designers in another perspective. Okay, so what is different in design thinking? You know, from early our childhood, we are facing with different thinking perspectives. We have analytical thinking, rational thinking, logical thinking, data-driven thinking, critical thinking, practical thinking, theoretical thinking. So our brain is so complex and so sophisticated that it can look from different perspectives. Design thinking doesn't tell us to just forget about those and apply design thinking. Design thinking is a combination of all those things. From a perspective, it is not traditional. In traditional thinking, you only think. In design thinking, you first think, then make. It is a doing methodology. So in traditional thinking, you avoid failures, you avoid uncertainty. So you don't want surprises. But in design thinking, you are open all to all those things. That is how innovation comes to the table. So and while you are just thinking in traditional thinking, doing rigorous analysis, on design thinking, you are just in the streets, on the field, doing experimentation. Maybe you build something quick, it will fail, but you will learn from your failure. So this is how design thinking differs from traditional thinking. Also, one other side of design thinking tells us to use both sides of our brain. You know, our brain on the left-hand side, it is very logical, analytical, rational, purely objective, acts with patterns, acts with data, acts with facts, and also it is very planned, structured. It's like the black and white side of our body. Can you solve a problem with just your left brain? I don't think so. That is what design thinking says. It says that in order to solve a problem, you need to also think from your right brain. You need to add creativity. You need to look from an holistic perspective. You need to be intuitive. You need to use your cognitive abilities. You need to be spontaneous even. So those things, when you add them up, they add a really nice flavor to your problem-solving skills. So that is why, in this sense, we will use our right brain. Also, when you face with a problem, what you do is just like safety switch. You go to your past experiences. You look at the past. What kind of experiences did I have? What kind of patterns did I observe? What stories did I listen to? What kind of observations did I make? So those things we do, and what we use them as benchmarks. So when we are trying to solve a problem, we just focus on the past. But what about the future? Okay, maybe future is not real. Maybe future is imagination. Maybe future is just talking about possibilities and uncertainty, but you need to think from those perspectives as well. So in most of the cases, as testers, as us, we are really stuck in project schedules. We couldn't find to do imagination. We couldn't find time to to think from a futuristic perspective. Those are not maybe required from us. They gave us some requirements. They gave us the project schedule. So they say that this should be tested and we just jump onto the activities and we mostly use our left brain. Mostly we use our past experiences. So that is also one nice dimension in design thinking. What else? In design thinking is like a mechanism of design thinking, is the algorithm how design thinking works. It says that in design thinking, you need to first generate things, then you need to prioritize them. So first you do generation, then you do synthesis. It means first you apply divergent thinking where you are just covering all the aspects. You look from a holistic perspective, you cover all the things, all the possibilities. Then because that our time and resources are limited, so we are not in heaven, what we need to do, we need to prioritize. We need to put focus on some area. So we need to do synthesis. We need to apply convergent thinking. So in each and every phase of design thinking, you solve that. So when you empathize to your audience, maybe you have 10 different personas, 10 different user profiles, but are they all have the same priority for you? Maybe not. Maybe these two users are more essential to your problem, so that you need to put more focus on those people. In a way, you do positive discrimination in that sense. So when you define all the problems, all the sub problems in the second stage, do you have the ability to solve each and every problem? I guess not. So what you do, first you list all the problems, but in the end of the defined session, you need to do prioritization, synthesis to select, to pick some critical problems. When you come to ideation, is the same story. So can you solve everything? No. So can you just implement all the ideas? Of course, no, you need to pick among those. So that is how design thinking works, and it could be applied to anywhere. So how can we use now it in software testing? So just very briefly, to show you the thing. So what we do, how do we construct design thinking in testing is, first you set an objective. So what problem does this software product solve for its audience? So in a way, we don't question it in many cases, to be honest. We just look at the requirements. So a tester should understand what the software product is built for. So he or she needs to look from that perspective. What problem this software, this specific software, is solving? So first we need to set it. Then we come to the empathy phase, where we are learning about our audience. So who are our users? Who are suffering from that problem? Who will be using our software? So you need to do empathy on those. Then you need to define their point of view, their insights, their needs and problems. Then based on their needs, what you do? You start ideation. You come up with testing ideas now this time, because we are in testing field. So what I would do as an ideation, I came up with different test ideas. What type and kind of testing should I do? Those things. And after the ideation phase, you need to do prototyping. You need to convert your testing ideas into maybe solid test cases by doing prototyping. And then in the end, you will test your testing. This test is testing your tests. So this is a hashtag I am using frequently. So as testers, we need to test ourselves. We need to test our testing. So let me proceed. So 10 tips or ideas to make better. First, as testers, we are all solution oriented. So most of the managers, upper managers, they are saying those things. Don't come to me with a problem. Come to me with a solution. Yeah, but without putting emphasis on the problem, how can you solve it? So this is what we are missing in so many areas. We don't put attention to problems. We are always solution seekers. So that is why we have that problem and solution space. You should not start with the solution space. In most of the testing activities, we just start with a solution space. So we know what we need to do. But what was the problem there? We didn't have time for that. So for those things, there are so many nice and very widespread examples. Like Henry Ford said, if I had asked people what they wanted, they would have said faster horses. But he didn't build faster horses, because faster horses is just a solution, is not the problem. So at those times, do you think that people, main problem of the people are that because they are horseless? I don't think so. So their problem is they want to go from a place to another place fast. So this was the problem. That is why he made up the automobile. So if you start with a solution, you don't see any alternative solutions. You need to be lucky to be successful with that solution. But if you find time to understand the problems, then you have the alternatives, like the spaceman problem. You know, they asked astronauts in NASA, they asked that, what do you need in space? And they said that we need pen. And they built up a space pen, which is $1 million project. But what do you think? Is it the problem? The problem in space is that the astronauts, they are lack of pens, or they want to write something down. That is why the Russian solution came up, where they are just putting a pencil, a regular pencil, into a nice box, and they call it Russian space pen, which is a very basic pencil, which can even write in zero gravity. So you don't need a space pen. I don't mean here space pen is trash. Of course, we need also space pen. But if you just start with a solution, you don't see alternatives. That is important in testing. So, fine. We understand what that specific software product is solving. So now, let us learn about our audience. So you need to do your persona definition. You need to understand your users. When we are talking about personas, of course, you need to understand who your users are, and what are their behaviors, and how they are using the software product. So in a very basic sense, In many of the persona definitions, people are putting attention to demographic targeting, where they are using age, gender, income, place of birth, whatever. So those things. But those things are not that critical in doing user profiling. When you are doing user profiling, you need to look for the behavior. It means that it doesn't matter the age. For instance, if you define your personas in a demographic way, maybe you have your first group of people like with ages to 20 to 30, and the other group from 30 to 50, but it doesn't make really sense. What it makes sense is the behavioral targeting. So how do they use this software product in a behavioral way? How do those people differ from each other is the thing. So I think these joke is very spread in the internet. They told that, if you do demographic segmentation, for instance, in your focus group, you have Prince Charles and Ozzy Osbourne sitting next to each other. I don't think those people have similar behaviors. So they are purely different people. But if you do demographic targeting, they are in the same group, but you could not extract any pattern from those people. So you need to do behavioral targeting. And in maybe 10 years ago, when we were talking about persona definition, we were just filling in the template with so many demographic things. But currently, how we use it with mental models. We use it with frustrations of the persona. We try to underline their goals, their pain points, their preferred brands, their personality. So those things are more important than they are demographics. They say much more than those. And so next generation persona definition is more dependent on the psychological aspects of every persona. And of course, in the end, what you do, you need to prioritize your persona based on their population, based on how frequent do they suffer from the problem, based on how critical they are, and how can they pass their experience, how can they influence others. So this is, because that I have slides, I need to be a little bit quick here. So you need to prioritize your personas, your users of your software product. It is not the end of the story, by the way. So you are in the empathy phase. You do behavioral segmentation, then you prioritize your personas, and in the end, you need to create an empathy map. And in the empathy map, you need to understand how do those people act? What does that specific user think and feel? What does that specific user hear from others? What do they do? What do they say? What do they see? And in the end, after filling on the left-hand side, you go for the pain and you go for the gain. So you would just tell their fears, their frustrations, the obstacles, and also their what they need, their measures of success, and what do they really want. So this is the end of the story. So this is how we complete the empathy phase. So when we come to the define phase, what you need to do, you need to create a point of view. You need to create their fishbone diagram. It's like point of view. We say that user, what he or she needs, and what insight can I extract from that point of view. Very basically, in the second step of design thinking, what we do is we create a fishbone diagram. We can. So in the fishbone diagram, on the head of the fish would be the main problem. And then you have that colorful boxes showing you the root causes and sub problems. So you need to thinking from the persona's point of view, because now I just completed the empathy phase. So I know my users very well. I know their frustrations, their pain points, their obstacles, their needs, so that I can define all those sub problems and needs. And in the end, I need to prioritize them again. Again, I'm telling you, you need to do divergent and convergent thinking. So first, just list everything, all the sub-problems they are suffering from. And then you need to prioritize that with like Moscow priorities. You need to use what is the impact of the problem and what is the likelihood of the occurrence of the problem. So basically the frequency of the problem. So if you just multiply those two dimensions, you may prioritize your problems. And then, so where I am now, I am in the third phase. So first, I set a target. I know that what problem is software product is solving. Then I create my personas. They understand their perspectives. Then I define their point of view. And now I came to the third stage where I am creating or generating ideas. Basically, you need to answer what type and kind of testing I need to do. So this is what we need to come up with in the ideation phase, which is very, by the way, enjoyable. So we need to generate test ideas. While we are generating test ideas, we are working in groups. We are not alone, of course. This is a very critical prerequisite for using design thinking. In order for you to use design thinking, you need to act as a group. You need to do teamwork. You need to be together. So in most of the cases, testers, they are alone. We don't have support from other members because they are fully occupied with different tasks. So for here, we are joining forces. So we are representing different viewpoints. So what we come up with, test ideas. A very could be intangible, it could be really wild. And also we speak one by one. And so there will be one conversation at a time. So we need to keep it visual. Also, we need to keep focused. And we need to go for quantity. Because what we do, first we do divergent thinking. We need to go for quantity. Maybe if you have more and more test ideas, it is better. But in the end, what you do, you need to prioritize those test ideas. Of course, you are not going to do each and every testing. So what you do is basically you do that benefit and those benefit trade-off analysis, where you are putting your test ideas in a quadrant, where you are assessing the benefit of that test, also ease of implementation. So you see that on the upper left, you have test ideas A and B, which are producing correspondingly high benefit, and they are easy to implement. So go for those. So this is a very logical prioritization schema for idea generation. So now we have test ideas. Not concrete. This is a little bit intangible, a little bit up in the air, but we have ideas. So what we need to do next? You need to create prototyping. It means that you need to, in order to test your testing, in order to test your testing, you need to turn those ideas into tangible outputs. It means you are creating test cases in a sense. So you are coming up with test cases. You just pick the valuable ideas which are bringing more benefit and they are easy to implement. So based on those ideas, you create some test cases. And for the test cases, you need to test your test cases. So while you are testing your test cases, you need to ask this question: what do I need to know from this test? What am I going to get? What would be the outcome of this test? What is the aim here? What is my objective here? So you just need to ask questions that you need answered. So in the end, what kind of template you use in order to test your test cases, just a very simple quadrant like this. So all the testers, they are together. They come up with different test cases and in a group. What we do, we test our test cases. So for instance, if I have the turn, I would tell you this test case, I like it because of this. I don't like it because of this. These are my questions because I could not understand all the details of that specific test case. And also I have some new ideas for you. But take this into consideration. You need to be very brief here. So you don't come up with hundreds of test cases. It is just an additional aspect into your testing, adding the user perspective to your testing. So please keep that into consideration. So by completing all those things, quadrants for each group members, then you can, of course, do some iterations. Based on the feedback you got from your test stage, you will improve your test cases and then you are done. So why we do it? Why we are deploying design thinking into testing? Because we know that testing is not always black or white. It maybe it has been taught to us that testing should be factful, should be quantitative all the time, but it is not always quantitative. Am I right? So testing is sometimes qualitative. It means that it should be intuitive. It should be covering the feelings. So it is gray from time to time because we are human beings. So what we do while we are testing this was in my book, I was emphasizing about the fourth dimension in testing. We know all three dimensions where we have all the unit integration system testing, the test levels, also functional, non-functional testing, regression, retest, confirmation. But on the fourth level, maybe we need to deploy positive testing, negative testing, emotional testing, objective testing. You need to switch hats. So that is why we are using design thinking in testing. We need to fill in the blanks. We need to add an emotional and intuitive flavors to our testing. Otherwise, our testing is more specification-based most of the times. It is more scripted. It is more structured. It is more objective, but it should be subjective as well. So and in many cases we don't just use user's perspective. We act as a tester, so we are not users. Even we are using the product in our real life, we are not users, because testing is our profession. That is important. Why we are using design thinking here? Because design thinking tells us to focus on things, to get rid of unnecessary things. Maybe you list all the ideas, but you don't go for each and every idea. Maybe you have all the possible test cases, but you don't go for those things. So because that you don't have time to test all those things, what you need to do, you need to apply divergent and convergent thinking into testing, because that based on the very, very fundamentals of testing, it says that you cannot test everything. You cannot test 100% any software because you don't have time. And also, what do I have? Teamwork. We are lack of this in many cases. In most of the projects, we are alone. We are working independently, individually. So it is not, if you are adding more perspectives, if you are reviewing each other's work, I think that would be the betterment of testing. So it would make your testing better. So why we use design thinking in testing is it pushes or encourages us to be work as a team. Maybe we have individual and different tasks, but for the design thinking side, we came together and we give our friends some different perspective and we assess their test cases and ideas, so that that would be better testing. By the way, my numbers are because I switch my slide to the I shift it to the right. It is not proper, but my last slide would be. So why in testing, I think the most important and critical thing is testing is maybe the whole testing is complementary. So when you have a new dimension in testing, it doesn't replaces the things that you have in the past. So in testing, we have so many different perspectives. In testing, you have black box and white box testing. Can you say me that if I do really nice white box testing, I could omit black box testing? No, they are complementary. Can you tell me that we do very nice functional testing, so we can skip performance testing or usability testing, functional, non-functional? When they come together, when they join forces, they are better. You have static and dynamic testing. Can you tell me that because we do very nice code review, we don't need any dynamic testing? I don't think so. When they combine together, they are in a better way. So can you tell me, because we have automation and it is very trendy and hot topic and next generation testing, can you omit human testing, manual testing? You cannot. So they are stronger when they are together. Also, scripted versus exploratory testing. Can you tell me that exploratory testing is better than scripted testing, or vice versa? I don't think so. So when they are together, they are better. So verification, validation from a perspective. So in our case, design thinking represents the validation side. Have we built the right software is the question it answers. But in most of the cases, we are asking another question. Are we building the software right? Yes, it is verification. We need to verify the software as well, but we need to also act from users' shoes. So we need to think from their perspectives. We should not just leave it to user acceptance tests. So I think this is important. This is why we have design thinking in testing. I think it has very deep value. I saw it again, perfectly. It works in my case. So I have 5 minutes. I am packing up, so I am almost done. So design thinking could be applied to anywhere, of course, we know it, which is a very nice and simple framework, very easy to understand. It just pushes us to act as a team, to get different testers' perspective, not only testers, could be also developers, analysts, project managers as well. So in design thinking activity, you can involve all the people in your team. That is one side. The other side is you are listing all the ideas, then you focus on the priorities. So you don't miss anything. You just list everything, and then in order not to miss those, and you get to know your users. In many cases, testers, they are unaware of the end users. They just test a product without thinking of the end users. But we need to do empathy on those people, because they will be the ones who will use this software, not me. Maybe for me, it is nice, but what about a 70-year-old person who has different cognitive abilities than me would be using the same software? Did you do any empathy on that? No. But yeah, it is, you do, then you do verification. So in most of the tests, I mean, system testing, we are lack of validation. So that dimension also should be added to testing. Also, in a sense, we are in an agile environment. So it means that we cannot only do scripted testing. In that perspective, when you apply design thinking to software testing, it is more of an exploratory activity. So it's just uses the brain skills. It's not only checking things, it is also using your brain to do creative things. Also, as I have told you, testing is not only black or white. It should be creative, it should be intuitive, and those things will be coming with design thinking. So it is very helpful for us. I would just strongly recommend everyone here to use it. And if you need any guidance, just let me know. Just let's get in touch, let's get in connected, so that in a friendly way, I would support you guys. So thank you for listening. I hope that I am in the timing, and if you have any questions for me, I would be happy to answer.
Thank you so much, Baris, for giving us again expanding the testing and how we can both put ourselves more close to the users and get more engagement, both in the teams and other perspectives. So it was really very interesting. Do we have any questions from the audience? I can see some applauses, but it would be great if we have a question for Baris.
I see a hand from Umut. Ah,
great.
I guess I know Umut. We were working in the same project with Umut, so just hello to him, and if you gave him the microphone, maybe he would come on to stage.
You have gave the permission.
Yeah. Hi.
Yes. Yes. Hi.
First of all, Baris, long time no see, and
very my friend. Yes.
The great community that you built. It is fantastic. Let me quickly jump into the question, so the whole forum will not get bored about our time together. I would like to ask, what do you think about the design thinking and thinking design, or let me say the testing design, in the V model perspective? When the design thinking should start and you should go into fruition in the test design and test implementation before it goes to the test execution?
Because, very nice question. Yeah.
Because that I can see most of your problems or the questions about how can a 70-year-old man can, for example, interact with the interface can be very costly if you find the kind of a bug at the very last minute. This should be involved maybe a lot earlier. If you can explain that part a little bit more, I will really appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you for the very nice question, Umut. It is always a pleasure to be with you. So thanks for coming, by the way. I am very happy that you are here. And for the question, it was very nice. Yeah, not only we use design thinking in agile environments, of course. You can use it in vModel. I think even in vModel, it makes it more agile. So because in vModel, what you leave all the user acceptance testing to the end, where you are telling me. So it is on the, you just shift your validation testing to the end of the cycle, which is, I agree with you, creating a lot of problems. When you encounter any problems on user acceptance testing, maybe you don't have any time or budget to fix that problem. So in design thinking, what we do it earlier, maybe in the integration and system testing. That is why we started that after maybe unit testing in a V model or a waterfall or a sequential model. We started earlier, so that is why we in a way guarantee to have the user perspective before beforehand, before the user acceptance starts. We already deployed the user perspective while we are on the integration phase, designing our scripted test cases. We can even do design thinking at the same time, simultaneously. So in the end, some of the portion of our tests, they are scripted and purely specification based, whereas some small portion could be coming from the design thinking. So I think this will answer your questions. So you need to start it while you are starting integration or system testing. That is why, in a way, you are shifting left your user perspective testing, so that guarantee to fix those bugs in a more or less expensive way. So hope that it answers your question, and it was a very nice question also. Thank you.
We have also other questions coming. So there's a question based on how, which parameters somebody can take as basis to add that artificial intelligence to design thinking.
Yeah, artificial intelligence, I think, is the next, is currently software in nowadays is artificial intelligence. It converted itself into artificial intelligence. Of course, we need to get prepared for that. I have sessions for that, but I saw that some other friends are talking about it. I want to move to a more human side of testing. But if you are testing an artificial intelligence product, still it should be produced for human beings. And if it is produced for human beings, you need to also validate that product, whether it includes artificial intelligence or not. I don't think it is creating so big difference here. Because when you read the book from Boris Beiser, which was authored like 35 years ago, almost 90% is still valid. I think design thinking is just bringing users onto the table in the artificial intelligence era. I think the human side could be a little bit neglected, and with design thinking, we will guarantee that we are empathizing with real human users so that they are on the table and we are focusing on them in a good way. So I think in artificial intelligence testing, maybe this side is missing so that we can cover up with design thinking. Is it the thing? The second question, maybe if I have time or if I am done, I don't know. Just tell me where is the next session.
If you can actually type your answer throughout.
Okay, I will try to answer those by typing, and you can continue your program.
Yes, so perfect.
Nadzeya and Onur, so sorry for the time, and I will try to answer your questions by typing. And thank you for the chance for giving me the opportunity to be on the stage. I am proud of you. I am proud of all the fellows who came here. Thank you so much, and have a wonderful program, guys. Thank you.